Hello, everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Welcome. My name is Gosia Kuczmowska. I am based in Warsaw, Poland, and I am the Logistics and Personnel Specialist of the Global Leaders Program. To support arts institutions, entrepreneurs, musicians, and educators impacted by evolving uncertainties, the Global Leaders Program, together with leading partners, is making available a series of sector-specific resources and learning events designed to promote professional growth. So far, these open enrollment webinars have caught the attention of people connecting from more than 45 countries around the world. We feel honored to have you all here, and we do hope this initiative will keep helping you get through these challenging times. Art as Action sessions are co-presented by Luan Museo Emocional and the Global Leaders Program to help participants discover a variety of perspectives, the power of art, beauty, and truth as a force for action in society and our everyday lives. Before we start, a few housekeeping requests. On the right-hand side of your screen, you will see a control panel which includes a questions section. Please go to this section now and write your name and country of residence, as well as your organization. We will receive and repost many of these into the chat box below to give you all a sense of a great diversity of participants joining today from around the world. This questions box is also where you can post comments later in the session to add perspective to the conversation. Again, we will post many of these into the chat box for the benefit of others. You are also encouraged to engage directly with our panelists by posting a question for one of them in the question box. Please submit your questions as early as possible in the session, as there will be a limit to how many can be answered. At the end of today's session, you will be prompted to complete a brief survey that will appear on your screens. We kindly ask that you share constructive feedback or suggestions for future sessions as we continue to evolve this growing series. Finally, please make sure to turn volume of your devices for the video materials that will be played during the session. Before we start, I would like to tell you a bit about our organizations. The Global Leaders Program offers an Ivy League curated executive graduate certificate in social entrepreneurship and cultural agency each year to an international cohort of 50 music professionals. Led in partnership with 9 top universities, including Harvard, Duke, Georgetown, NYU, and McGill, the Global Leaders Program's teaching faculty includes Nobel Prize receivers, Grammy winners, and TED presenters, who work with and support cohort members throughout a 9-month journey that combines an online and in-person university-led courses and retreats with on-the-ground field work in more than 40 countries. Today's session is co-hosted by Luan Museo Emocional.
How many times have we been told that it's wrong to feel? How many times have you walked and ignored the landscape? It's time to stop and think about what we can do today to change tomorrow, to realize that as long as the sun goes down and comes out again, there is an opportunity to make a change. Because if we can dream of a better world, we can create it. Let's explore beyond what we can see at a glance. Let's make our inspiration, imagination, and creativity the main elements of the world we want. Let's analyze our decisions and discover what drives us to go in a deep state of reflection that provides us with tools to create good day by day. May the freedom to play and the empowerment of our individual and collective ethics guide the way. Feel, believe, and create. The change we're waiting for depends on us. Luan, Emotional Museum.
Luan promotes art, knowledge, and ethical reflection. Luan, Museo Emocional, is a space that will open in 2021 where we teach ethics through art focused on how art can help improve mental health. The objective of these live sessions is to create ethical aesthetic experiences online based on the pillars of Luan: the good, the truth, and the beauty. Long-term vision, stop seeing things in a short-term way. Ethical decision-making, learn from the past, cultivate memory and history. Urgent optimism, amazement, and hope. Sense of community, the art of playing and creating. And now it is my great pleasure to introduce today's esteemed guest presenter and special guests. José Luis Falconi is lecturer of Latin American art in the Department of History of Art and Architecture at Brandeis University, as well as the president of Cultural Agents, an NGO which, as he will share later in this session, promotes civic engagement and creativity through artistic education. From 2010 to July 2017, he was a member of the Department of Art History and Architecture of Harvard University, where he received his doctorate in Roman languages and literatures in 2010. In the United States, he has been appointed visiting professor in the Department of Art History and Architecture of the University of Boston in the spring of 2016. In Latin America, he has been visiting professor at, among others, the University of Chile, National University of Colombia, Center for Latin American Studies at the Universidad San Carlos of Guatemala, and University of Costa Rica. Harvey Price. Harvey was an associate professor of percussion at the University of Delaware for 40 years, where he taught orchestral percussion, steel band, jazz vibraphone, and conducted the percussion ensemble. Harvey maintains an active freelance performance schedule with the Philadelphia Orchestra, the Chamber Orchestra of Philadelphia, the Opera Company of Philadelphia, and the Pennsylvania Ballet. Harvey is the founder, executive, and music director of Peace Drums, a shared experience music project that involves Muslim, Christian, and Jewish youth in Israel learning and performing music together in a steel drum band. Victoria Roman. German flutist Victoria Roman completed her master's and bachelor's degree at the University of Music in Dresden, Germany, and additionally studied early music performance at the Conservatoire National Supérieur de Musique et Danse in France. Victoria is a founding member of the contemporary chamber ensemble Hankel Music, which is based in Germany, and she is also the founder of an intercultural music project between Uganda and Germany, about which you will hear more later in this session. The project is called Architects of Music. Today's session will be moderated by Pedro Centeno, Academic Director of the Global Leaders Program. Welcome again, and Pedro, please take over.
Thank you so much, Gosha. Before passing the word to José Falconi, I wanted to start by sharing a little bit about the history of collaboration between the Global Leaders Program and Cultural Agents Initiative, because I think it creates a useful framing for today's session. And 3 years ago, through Harvard University's David Rockefeller Center for Latin American Studies, we connected with Dr. Doris Sommer, who is the director of Cultural Agents Initiative and also a literature professor at Harvard. And we invited her to our annual residence in the south of Chile to lead a full capacitation in a protocol that she developed called Pretexts, as part of the academic activities that we had on the ground for our cohort. And at first, and this is before experiencing Pretexts on the ground for the first time and seeing how our participant profile reacted to it, we felt attracted to Pretexts because of the intellectual argument that fostered its creation. Cultural Agents Initiative had developed an argument going back to Kant, going back to Schiller, that we felt didn't only support Pretexts as an arts and humanities-based social intervention, but really an argument that gave a foundation through the philosophy of aesthetics for anyone who feels the drive to envision ways in which art and or humanities can be harnessed to solve social problems. And today, in fact, this argument is a crucial part of our curriculum. We start our curriculum with José Falconi leading a unit that stems from that argument. For anyone interested in discovering what that whole world is about, you can read Doris Sommer's book, The Work of Art in the World. Now, the argument underscoring Pretexts is the reason why the Global Leaders Program started a collaboration with Cultural Agents Initiative. But then, after experiencing Pretexts for the first time on the ground, we quickly realized that Pretexts in itself represented a powerful tool for music teaching artists and music entrepreneurs who are leading social impact organizations. And one of the reasons why we think this is the case is because Pretexts invites music professionals, music teaching artists, music entrepreneurs to think beyond their specialized training in music, to kind of step back and rethink what their role is in the lives of their students, in the life of the beneficiaries of the organizations, and to see how they can accomplish more by blending music with literacy skills, with theater, with art making and reflection. So the emphasis here is on aesthetic experiences and aesthetic education to drive innovation and good citizenship. And I don't want to get ahead of ourselves here, because today's session was designed to give you a taste of this world. In pretext, doing is the raw material for learning, always. So we'll start with an activity led by Jose Falconi, and then we'll hear from Victoria Roman and Harvey Price, both of whom completed the GLP, and both of whom have used pretexts in the social impact music organizations they founded. So again, thank you everyone for being here, and Jose, please take it away.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Can you guys hear me? Everyone okay?
Yes.
Perfect. Thank you so much. And thank you so much, Pedro, Harvey, Victoria, and the people at Luan, Marion, and Nathan, for this invitation. We are delighted to be here and to share with you a little bit about what pretext is, and also talk a little bit more about what cultural agents is. As you know, cultural agents, and I think Pedro kind of already dovetailed on it, cultural agents is an initiative we started almost 20 years ago at Harvard University. And it's now an initiative at the university as well as an NGO. And what do we do at, in cultural agents? What we do is we take art seriously. And the most important way of taking art seriously is by assuming that everybody is or could be an artist, and that artists do and then reflect, you know, on what they have done. And the way of taking art seriously is by doing something. And that is clearly reflected in our flagship program called Pretext, in which we use text, any text, to foster creativity, citizenship, and higher order learning. And that's something already Pedro has already said some about it. And we will be also expanding on that later when we talk a little bit about the experiences that they have had. So in order to actually introduce you to pretext, and I mean, to we can give you a lecture about pretext, but why we don't actually do an exercise? And in that way, the very practice of it, you know, will lead us to something, will show us what we're trying to do or what is our method. I will need a reader. Harvey, very good, wonderful. You could be a reader. And all of you need to get a piece of paper. All of you get a piece of paper, blank piece of paper, and a pencil or crayons or whatever you want that you can draw. Like a, pick up an empty piece of paper. What you will do, what will happen right now is that you will listen to a text. Harvey, you have the text, is that correct? Yes, very good. Now, you will listen to a text while you draw. This is a tradition that we have brought and we have basically recycled, because we believe seriously in recycling too, recycling traditions, recycling methodologies, you know. And this is a tradition that comes, as you know, from the southern part of Spain and from all the Caribbean basin. These were very specialized manual labors as they produced cigars. And because they were specialized and manual rollers of tobacco, they used to have, they had some power against the boss, and they hire readers. They hire people that will read to them while they were rolling the tobacco. So that's why you have this incredible tradition of highly intellectual people, you know, that may have not been, they don't know how to read or write, you know. Maybe illiterate, but highly intellectual. And they hire those readers to read novels, to read important books, to read whatever, Marx sometimes, I mean, whatever it is they wanted to read. And that's one of the reasons why also, if you go and buy cigars, what are the famous names of the cigars? Monte Cristo, Romeo and Romeo and Juliet, all those names are because those were the factories that, those were the books that they like the most in that factory of cigars. Okay? This is, they were paying homage to their favorite books that they did while they were rolling tobacco. So what I want you to do right now is to, while Harvey reads, is to draw the imaginary book cover of this story, okay? And Harvey, take it away. Everyone is ready. Okay. Can we listen to Harvey well? Yes, I can listen to him. Yeah. Very good, perfect.
The Two Kings in the Labyrinth by Louise Borges. It is said by men worthy of belief, though Allah's knowledge is greater, that in the first days there was a king of the Isle of Babylonia who called together his architects and his priests and bade them build him a labyrinth so confused and so subtle that the most prudent men would not venture to enter it, and those who did would lose their way. Most unseemly was the edifice that resulted, for it is the prerogative of God, not man, to strike confusion and inspire wonder. In time, there came to the court a king of Arabs, and the king of Babylonia, to mock the simplicity of his guest, bade him enter the labyrinth where the king of Arabs wandered, humiliated and confused, until the coming of the evening when he implored God's aid and found the door. His lips offered no complaint, though he said to the king of Babylonia that in his land he had another labyrinth, and Allah willing, he would see that someday the king of Babylonia made its acquaintance. Then he returned to Arabia with his captains and his wardens, and he wreaked such havoc upon kingdoms of Babylonia with such great blessing by fortune that he brought low his castles, crushed his people, and took the king of Babylonia himself captive. He tied him atop the swift-footed camel and led him into the desert. 3 days they rode, and then said to him, O king of time and substance and cipher of the century, in Babylonia didst thou attempt to make me lose my way in a labyrinth of brass with many stairways, doors, and walls. Now the powerful one has seen fit to allow me to show thee mine, which has no stairways to climb, nor walls to impede thy passage. Then he untied the bonds of the king of Babylonia and abandoned him in the middle of the desert, where he died of hunger and thirst. Glory to him who does not die.
Thank you so much, Harvey. It's a beautiful, poignant story by Borges. Now, what I would like you to do is to do an interpretive exercise. And here, because our musical friends are here, our musician friends are here, we are going to be able to do a musical exercise. We are going to interpret the text and four fragments of music, and you are going to pair them to the text. In a minute, I will post the text down in the screen so for all of you to look at it. But the idea is that you will pair the sentences, the fragment to the sentences. There are only 7 sentences in the text, and I have marked them there. So for example, after you listen to the first fragment, you will pair it to lines 4 or 5. Okay? Or you will pair it to, and you then after you listen to fragment 2, you will pair it to line 3. Okay? The idea here is to be able to create your personal soundtrack, okay, of the text with the music that we are going to accompany, where we're going to provide to you. So if we can put up the text, that will be great.
Jose, you're muted.
Could everybody see the text? Yes, Pedro, Victoria, Harvey, can everybody see the text? Very good. You see the lines there. They're not actually 7, there are 8 lines. And what we're going to do is we're going to pass the fragments of the music. There are going to be four fragments. Could you please pass fragment number one, please?
And Jose, every time we start the video, you will be automatically muted.
Okay, very good. So if you could please now write down where are you pairing it, to which sentence are you pairing the first fragment? Let's give a few seconds to do that. Okay, everybody made this choice. Very good. So let's go to fragment number two, please. Thank you very much. Wait for a second so everybody can make their choice. Wonderful. Fragment number three, please. Wonderful. Thank you so much. Let's wait a few seconds for everybody to make their choice. So let's now do the last fragment number four. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for that. I think please finish up making your choices. Give you a few more seconds to do that. Wonderful. Wonderful. You're all here, you know? Very good. So now what we're going to do we are going to be using the, I think it's going to be the chat, in order to be able to say what are the results of the fragment. So you have on your right hand side, I think, among the many different tabs that you have one that is called chat, where you have been putting, where, I'm sorry? Yeah.
It's called questions. Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Questions. Mm-hmm. Very good. So one that says questions, okay, and then that's where you're going to be adding your answer. So when I say, for example, where do you pair fragment number one, you will place there the lines 3 and 4, whatever lines they are. Okay. Mm-hmm. So if you could just go ahead.
Yeah. I think we're following.
Very good. So if we can please put your answers to the question, that will be fragment on the, what lines do you pair it fragment number one? Do you pair fragment number one to?
And now, Jose, I will mm-hmm. read some of the answers that we're receiving. Salome Rato says line three would be for fragment one. Liana Ginsberg, 5. Viviana, 1. Hannah Dick, 1. John Harrison, 2.
Okay, Carthage, I see. 1. Very good. I can see them here. That's right. I can see them here. Okay, mm-hmm. Now let's go. If you have all put your answer there, please go to fragment number 2. To which lines do you pair fragment number 2?
And we're starting to receive answers. Mm-hmm. Kenny Brill says line 4. Viviana says 4. Hannah Dix says 4. Ami Lopez, 4. Kartik Gupta, 4. Gustavo Zamudio, 4. Rachel Cohen, 2 and 4.
Excellent. If we can if we can now tell me about fragment number 3, please.
And we're starting to see some answers. Ami Lopez says line 2, Rachel Cohen line 5, Hannah Dick 3, Viviana Tena 3, Gustavo Zamudio 2, Liana Ginsberg 2, Kartik Gupta's 5.
Wonderful. And the last fragment number 4.
Fragment number 4 is being matched with line 6. Line 6, Marie Medina says 4 and 5. John Harrison, 1. Rachel Cohen, 1. Liana Ginsberg, 7. Viviana Tena, 7. Marion Cortina, 4.
Wonderful. So, I mean, it will be wonderful to see it as a sort of a result. You know, we can, I mean, I by some reason I cannot read it here, but I'm sure that you guys can do it on the right side. But what is important here is a couple of things. What have we done? And actually, that's a question that we always ask in this very short exercise. There's a question that we always ask what we do in pretext. After any activity, we ask that question. We ask a question of reflection. If there would have been more time, of course, we have let, you know, you guys read it, I mean, listen again, maybe have a change of mind, you know. But what is important to understand, what have we done? We have been able to interpret a text with the aid of a piece of music that you guys interpret, both the piece of music and the text, and that exercise in itself helped us to read the text in a much more attentive way. And the fact that we are asking to interpret through an art allow us for a far more detailed analysis of the text, you know. And a text which, by the way, is not easy at all, is Borges, one of the most difficult writers that we have in not only Spanish language, but in the last 20s I mean, in the last part of the 20th century. And on top of that, even in the case of there were some repetition about where to put the fragments, they were all in an immense variety. They all show an immense variety. Everybody had their own particular soundtrack. Okay, this is the exercise that we wanted to really briefly put in front of you in order to be able for you to understand how pretext works. You know, we try to do things, and that is the way in which we are trying to learn, you know. And so now I would love to have Pedro and then Harvey and Victoria talk a little bit about their experiences. The last thing I would like to say, is that pretext, as we said, is one of the programs that Cultural Agents has, you know. And I say at the beginning, a Cultural Agents is we try to take art seriously. What we do in Cultural Agents is to look at the ways in which art intervenes in society. We believe that art is a very powerful tool to social intervention, and those moments where things are stale, they're at a moment in which there is an impossibility of decision, or things are basically not working out, art can be a very powerful tool. And for that, of course, this is our flagship program, Pretext, which allows you to interpret art through another art. But also we have programs that go from working on symbolic reparations, on basically the way in which, for example, monuments — it's a conversation that is very, very poignant and very important these days — how do monuments help to heal? Which monuments help to heal? When are we working on, how do these images or these memorials that we put a lot of attention and a lot of importance in are able to help us in a healing process as a society? Two programs that have to do, for example, with domestic violence through the conversation of soccer, which is called Football Viral. We are doing that in Brazil. You know, Futebol Viral, that will be in Portuguese, of course. But we have worked, as I say, for 20 years in trying to showcase the importance of the art and the way in which, you know, it really is capable of entering those spaces that normally economical determinism, you know, saying like, well, the only thing that you need is money, quote unquote. The only thing that you need to do is to put money, or there is such a thing as, if there is no political will, well, maybe the arts are able to insert themselves and able to open spaces that were not there before. That's what Cultural Agents — I'll invite you to look at our webpage, look at the webpage of Pretext, and to be in contact with us, you know, just in the same way that Pedro got in contact with us, and now we are working together with these wonderful musicians. But our idea is to showcase, study, and then of course promote the importance of the arts in order to achieve a society that could be more engaged, that could be, and also a better learned — a society that could have high order learning and be and capable of being critical. Okay, so with that having said, you know, I would love to pass it to Pedro and then to Harvey and to Victoria, and then we can open the conversation to all of us. No, is that correct?
Fantastic. Thank you, Jose, so much. As I mentioned at the beginning, here Harvey and Victoria are alumni of the Flow Leaders program. They represent artists who took art seriously, to borrow from your wording, Jose. they decided that it was on their hands to use music as a platform for, and we're going to learn about what their platforms are doing through music in different corners of the world. Victoria recently gave birth, and I can hear that the baby is not crying at the moment, so I think it would be Great to start with you, Victoria. And then we're going to move to Harvey.
All right, thank you. Yes, the baby is and taking care of him very well. thank you so much for inviting me to today's session and to talk about our experience using pretext in our project called Architects of Music in Kampala, Uganda. Maybe I talk a little bit about the project first, then sharing our experience of implementing pretext. So as you know, I am based in Dresden, Germany, but we're having the project's heart is in Kampala in Uganda, and our mission is building bridges through music. That's why we also chose the name Architects of Music. And we provide high quality intercultural music education that empowers young people and develops their skills for a successful future. And we want to create communities where people realize their potential and become agents of social change. And Architects of Music is an intercultural music program, and we offer both Western style music education and traditional Ugandan and East African music education, dances, traditional instruments, songs, alongside flute playing and music history. Theory and also history. And we are a team of three founders, two Germans and one Ugandan musician. It's me, then my colleague Regina Rote from Dresden. She's also a flutist. We studied together, and our colleague from Uganda called Joseph Ochen, and he's a professional Adungu player, which is a Ugandan harp. He's also constructing those instruments himself, and he's really a key person in our project. He's actually the program director in Kampala, and managing everything there, the daily trainings, all the activities, and all the flute lessons. When Regina and I, we are not there, we are doing it online. We are exchanging videos, basically, recording videos, and creating music sheets for them to keep on their learning despite our absence. And I want to talk a little bit about why Uganda, because it's not the neighbor of Germany. So I met Joseph in 2016 on a concert tour to Eritrea. I went there with an orchestra, and there was a kind of a festival, international festival, where international music and cultural groups were invited. And we stayed in touch after that musical experience on the ground in Eritrea. We already shared some musical hours, exchanging knowledge about our instruments. And 1 year later, I traveled to Uganda to visit all of my new friends over there and learning more about the music. And that's actually when the idea of Architects of Music has been created or was born. And I traveled back to Germany with all my ideas in my head. And then I had a great partner, found a great partner in Regina, who was very excited about the program, ideas I had in my mind. And so we started to host fundraising concerts to raise the first money to provide instruments for the group in Kampala. And that was also my motivation to join the Global Leaders Program in 2000 for the cohort 2019, to be able to harness all the abilities you need for creating a social music project, to not only focus on music, but also know about the business and management behind the scenes, which is really very important to keep the program going. Now we also created an association in Germany last year to support the program in Kampala financially through donations and grants, and still hosting these fundraising concerts, which is not possible at the moment, unfortunately, but we hope to resume very soon. And as I told already, the group in Kampala is the heart of the project, but we are also aiming to realize international exchange between young people from Germany and our youth in Kampala, and later at large in the future between other countries in Africa and also in Europe and the world at large. Our first little exchange was in April 2019 when Joseph visited Dresden, and we gave many workshops in Ugandan music in various schools, and outside of Dresden and in the city of Dresden. So at the moment in Kampala, there are around 30 to 40 active members who are meeting for weekly trainings, and we also host holiday camps for them to dive deeper into the musical experience and to create like a family. And now I would like to play the first video to give a short impression of what is happening in Architects of Music, how we combine also the Western and the African music instruments. Thank you. So that was a very brief video, but we regarding the time, I just wanted to play some few seconds. You can explore more when you visit our Facebook page after the webinar. now coming to the pretext story of Architects of Music. So I learned about the pretext method last year during the full cohort residence of the Global Leaders Program in Chile alongside Doris Sommer. And it was very inspirational to implement this method in our work with Architects of Music, because after the residence, we traveled to Kampala in February 2019. And we realized an African-European production of Mozart's Magic Flute through the pretext method. But it was actually not our plan at first hand to create this production. Regina and I, we had a rough plan to introduce the Magic Flute to the members in Kampala, a very unknown piece to them, completely a new style, genre of music they had never heard before. And the whole production was made of all the ideas our members gave us through the pretext activities. So we came up with the idea of putting all of them together and designing some scenes, and also taking African dance elements into the whole story of the Magic Flute. And we also started off with the reading of the text and designing book covers with our members, and therefore I would like to play the second video, please.
But he is also he's still alive. Play the magical flute and witnesses how much power for the first time. As he plays, world pieces of all kinds come forth and listen to him. Surprised, he stops and the wild beasts ran away. He continues to play.
Okay, thank you. So there was a brief in that activity. Sorry. After that, we also asked all of the members who were designing the book covers to write down questions. It was exactly the same process as we did in Chile to learn the pretext. So I implemented all of these activities. So they were asking questions about the story, and we also hang them on a clothesline such that they could go along and read them again after knowing more about the story. And it was really very interesting how they could dive into the plot of the Magic Flute and get to know the story by studying it by themselves, and not just putting them in front of a screen and let them watch the opera, but to engage with the story. And we also played some musical excerpts designed for two flutes, and they had to match with the characters after they did their own interpretation of some the main characters of the Magic Flute. And here I want to show a little video where they interpreted Monostatos and Pamina. We divided the members into small groups, and we gave them the main characters by random choice. So then they had a little time to go through the text to see what is the character like and how we represent it in a very short acting scene. And that's what I would like to show you now. Yeah, we were really overwhelmed by all the creativity we experienced coming from our members through the pretext activities. We never knew before that we had great actors among the group who could interpret beautiful scenes of the Magic Flute. And also we had never text activities within our musical trainings. So we didn't know how they would react to that, because they have also very different levels of education. Most of them, they are not used to read long texts or to dive deep into a text, because they dropped out of school early, or they had some years of school due to moving to another city. And yeah, so that was a beautiful outcome of the implementation of pretext, and also all the activities we did also to prepare them for the acting strengthened the group so much, the sense of belonging to the group, and also creating kind of a family act. Architects of Music is for them, and also especially also for Regina and me, who are only traveling there several times a year. We don't see them every day or every week like Joseph does, but through the activities we got really close to them, and that was a beautiful thing. And yeah, in the end, we created our magic flute, a 1-hour performance, and we got the chance to present it in front of over 800 children of a primary and secondary school in Kampala. And we created like a 7-minute video of this magic flute, which you can watch on YouTube. And I would like to show you now a 1-minute brief scene out of this video to show you the end, the result of our activities.
You must be my lifesaver. Thank you, I'm Tamino. My name is Papageno. Sure, I need to help you. Please come with me.
Papageno is very happy with his life, yet he does not know that his life will be changing soon. The Queen of the Night shows Tamino a picture of Pamela. He is fascinated by her beauty, his love at her side.
Yes, beautiful. Thank you. Thank you so much for giving me the time to share all of this experience. And I'm happy to answer questions in the end of the session. And yeah, we can share the link of the YouTube video in the chat box. And you can find us on Facebook. And there also we have the link to a website, architectsofmusic.com. So I think you will find everything.
Thank you so much. We have been posting those links in the chat box already. So thank you for walking us through the mission of your program, the activities that you have led, and how Pretext has been implemented to advance Architects of Music's mission. So thank you so much. If anyone has questions for Victoria, just type them in the question box and we'll get to them right after Harvey's introduction to his program, Peace Drums. So Harvey, please take it away.
And we could start with the video. That'll answer a ton of questions right away.
Right.
Peace Drums got started when a group of clergy in Wilmington, Delaware decided to put a program together that was an investment in peace in the Middle East. And they approached me. I had an idea that was flying around for a while to do a youth steel band made up of Muslim, Christian, and Jewish students. And I put a band together and I was amazed at how quickly musicians and non-musicians could come together and learn music on steel band. And it quickly became evident to me that it was the ultimate tool for music education. Well, the steel drum from Trinidad is an instrument that doesn't belong to either the Arab or Jewish culture in Israel. It's an instrument that was born out of conflict about 70 years ago in Trinidad and Tobago. Well, this is their third international tour. Their first tour from Israel was to the US in 2016. Last October, we went to Vienna to help celebrate the 500th anniversary of the Lutheran Church. We got to perform in the most important concert hall in Europe called the Musikverein. And this year, we are helping the Leo Beck Educational Institute in Haifa to celebrate their 80th anniversary. And last week, we were in Mannheim. Tonight, we just finished a concert in London. And tomorrow, we'll go to Zurich. Music is the ultimate nonverbal communication art form. They don't look at one another as Christian or Arab or Jewish or Muslim or Israeli, or they look at one another as a band member. Well, the future of Peace Drums is really about growing the band. We have senior high school kids, junior high school kids, elementary school kids. The more of those, the better. The more communities in Israel and Arab Jewish that get together, the better. So that's really the hope of it.
Okay, so
I wanted to say that I really appreciate the time to talk about Peace Drums and to talk about pretext, which is something that came to me during the classes last January in Futiar with Dr. Sommer. Many of the topics that she touched on really resonated with me as a musician, and particularly in the program that I run in Israel. And like Victoria, I live in Philadelphia. Israel's about 5,500 miles from where I live. I'm there about four times a year when we're allowed to travel. And so I do have I have several full-time people working there. I have a full-time music director who is Trinidadian. He actually lives in Haifa, Israel. We have to renew a visitor's visa every year. And he sees about 150 kids a week in 10 to 15 groups of which is the as many drums as we have at various schools. So the thing about pretext that really resonated with me, the first thing was the talk of recycling. And we use recycled instruments. I mean, the steel band is all about recycled oil barrels. The history of the instrument is all about that. And that was one of the things that I said really resonated with me. And all the instruments you saw in that video all got their start as 55-gallon oil drums and were made by artisans in Trinidad. And so that was the first thing that really struck me. And the second thing that struck me was the education within a circle. And when we rehearse steel band, we rehearse in a circle, so that it's a fairly wide circle. If you have 15 or 20 musicians, it takes up, the instruments are large and they take up a large space. And when I teach or whomever's teaching, we're just part of the circle. So that, like those two things right away really got me interested in using pretext exercises and just the whole concept of getting the students to relate on that level. The third thing that really struck me was that one of the things that we were going to implement this year, beginning after January, was a new program, not new to Israel, but a new program to me called Writers Matter. And it's also founded by a Philadelphian, just coincidentally, a gentleman, a retired English teacher from LaSalle University, English professor that lives like a mile from me. And he has a very large program in Philadelphia. He sees 3,600 kids a year. And he has a program in Israel, a similar program that sees about 300 or 400 kids. And Writers Matter basically has children in Israel writing in their mother tongue, whether it's Arabic or Hebrew, about topics which relate to them. What's your family like? Where do you live? You know, what foods do you eat? What music do you listen to, for starters? And those questions and those exercises extend to how do you feel about your community and how do you feel about the world, and extends to poetry and extends to lyrics for music. So we started to incorporate this in our Peace Drums project. We got a few sessions in before COVID hit and shut everything down, but his program, like my program, the Writers Matter program, like Peace Drums, is based on shared society. So we're dealing with getting Israeli Arabs and Israeli Jews to see their society as something that they share together through writing and through music. I've been probably doing Peace Drums 4 to 5 years before I ever joined Global Leaders. So there were a lot of ideas that I had that I recognized within Global Leaders. But as Victoria said, there were some great things that really helped me to move the program along, just in terms of the nuts and bolts. But the idea that one of the ideas of Peace Drums, which did not come to fruition immediately, was the idea, my theory, that just get kids together from different cultures, so to speak, and have them play music and everything will be fine. And that, of course, didn't quite work out that way. And what I mean by that is the Jewish population and the Arab population within Israel itself, they basically live alongside one another separately. So they don't live in the same town. Some of them do, some of them don't. They definitely go to different schools. Obviously, they worship at different places, mosques, churches, and synagogues. And the families rarely interact, and I mean rarely interact. So even though our kids play music together and do look at one another as friends, and when they tour, they're really great buddies. The minute the music stops, whether it's a rehearsal or a concert, and it's time to eat, they go to their separate corners, which drives me nuts. I knew I needed another element of communication to get them to sort of look beyond, believe it or not, just the music in. And Writers Matter, I believe, and Pretext will do that. So I'll explain a little bit about the Pretext and how we started to use it and then we're kind of shut down. I actually started it in a class at the University of Delaware where I recently retired from. And what we did is we set up in a circle. I usually teach steel band from a drum kit. So I'm sort of at 12 o'clock and everybody else is around so we can all see one another. They're all standing, I'm sitting. Sorry, I don't have any video of this. We would have had tons of video had COVID not shut down. But anyway, one of the other things that resonated me was artists doing, right? And describing. And one of my pet peeves all throughout my own education and then my teaching for 40 years was the fact that the way music theory was taught, not by me, but taught in general, was that it was a very dry as dust. Like there was music theory and then there was music. And the way that I teach steel band is that music theory and the making of music is all one. And so I use pretext exercises by right away having students who have never played music or have never played steel drums before operate in a circle. They play scales, we play chords, we play chord progressions. We have them make up melodies, different students, and we go around the room. And it is really an incredible thing to have the students, you know, ask what they did and how they feel. And I know that once we get that into full swing in Israel, that will be a huge, huge plus. That would be a really great thing to do. So the idea that we're going from something abstract, like a text that is abstract until you really delve into it, until you really take it apart, until you really discuss it and turn it inside out. I use the same things in terms of music theory. And the fact that we operate in a circle, it will be very easy. I've already written these things out, but it'll be very easy to put the steel drum ballots down and have pieces of paper, have pieces of text laying in the pan, in the steel drum, and to discuss it and to do all of the things that Victoria did with her students, where you're making book covers, you're talking about exercises, you're even creating music on the steel drum right there to the text you're reading. I'm really excited about it. And if we can ever get through this insanity, we'll have some great video to share with you all. But just, you know, a couple takeaways of this is that the Caribbean and Latin American idea of recycling, you know, right away steel band is it. You know, it's the ultimate recycled instrument. In fact, there was an instrument that sounded so much like a steel drum, Victoria, in one of the videos. I need to see a little bit more. There was one very melodic instrument that I don't know what it was. I didn't get to see it. But and so using the idea of recycling, using the idea that we're doing something very abstract like music theory to music, you know, I'm talking about basic music theory to pretty complex music theory. And the one sort of nut I really have to crack, and actually Dr. Sommer and I discussed this a little bit, with last January was that my kids are in two different languages. We're in Hebrew and Arabic. They know some English, but I have to really figure out the text we're going to use to sort of get that together. I am excited to use Arabic texts and Hebrew texts, you know, both rich and, you know, deep culture, deep stories, which I think will generate some very interesting music. And then one of the eventual outcomes will be students writing music and writing lyrics to the music. Even though we're an instrumental band, we can certainly sing and play music at the same time. So those are, you know, those are my visions. I'm sure we'll be able to video these with, you know, sometime in the next year, have some great video to show you all. And that's where Peace Drums is in terms of pretext.
Thank you so much. And Jose, before passing the word to you, in case you would like to ask a question or two to Harvey and Victoria, I just wanted to underline some a similar element in these two stories, which is that both Victoria and Harvey ask themselves what their beneficiaries needed, right? And this is something that it takes courage as musicians and entrepreneurs in music to look for places other than music to try to find answers. And so both of you realized in different ways how bringing in literacy activities and art making and theater reflection really helped come closer to meeting the needs of your beneficiaries. Jose, if you have...
No, I mean, just, I mean, I actually want to underline another, I mean, you're underlining. So two quick things, and because they have been mentioned in passing, and it'll be good for the public to understand that pretext is a very simple protocol that is used continuously over and over and over in order to be able to create a habit, a new habit. And among the new habits that we have that we try to foster is one that comes from just simply the very physical position of people, which is we do everything in a circle because we need to see each other, you know, and we need to see the faces of each other, not just by simply replicating a position of authority of the teacher in front and the pupils in rows, you know, which come from other kind of traditions, you know. So this is important for us. I mean, and as they have been said in passing, I mean, Victoria talked a little bit about literatura de cordel, which is basically putting everything on a cloth line, you know, all your text, which comes from Brazil, you know, which is and from Chile too. Chileans also do literatura de cordel. And again, you know, we recycle, we try to gather good practices, you know, in order to be able to once more continue the idea of the interpreting and the reinterpreting, because that's precisely what recycling is. We continue to interpret and reinterpret, you know, in order to be able to get to a text and to be able to foster three main things that we believe are tied together. One, creativity, obviously, you know, by doing every single of the exercises, which is also central to music, of course, you know, but also we also want to not only teach students, I mean, to be creative, but also they are going to be good readers and writers, you know. Literacy comes there too. It's important to put an emphasis on the fact that if the people do not read and write, well, things are going to be very, very hard for them later. And on top of that, the other thing is that also coming into tandem, I mean, is the citizenship. I mean, the great increase in citizenship. You know, we believe that through the fostering of not only appreciation, but admiration between each other, I mean, between all the people in the group, we're able to foster civic engagement. We're able to create a new basis of society. It's much harder for anyone to discard you if they admire you. So we need to start thinking about a contract, a social contract in between all of us, in which it is not just simply tolerating someone, but admiring them. And in that admiration, which is produced by the fact that, well, that kid knows how to dance better. I mean, knows dances great, you know, or makes this interpretation great, or does this other thing great. And we are able to open a space in which we all admire each other. Things will be different. We'll be able to have a much more robust social contract that is based on differences and not just based on similarities. So that's what basically pretext is trying to do. And that's why I think it's important. And that's why, I mean, these two examples are incredible. Pedro.
Yes, we have a question coming from Abigail Dance. And Harvey, this one's for you. Let me find it. One second. There. She says, thank you for sharing about your project. Could you speak, you speak with such great energy about your program. Have you found any methods to help the young people on your program to integrate more fully away from the drums, or is this an ongoing mission? Thanks.
Yeah, this is an ongoing mission, and this was going to be implemented in March with Writers Matter and Pretext. So actually, the students are back rehearsing again, which is great. Israel sort of flattened the curve, so they were able to get back rehearsing again. But in August, we'll have a larger camp, like a 1 week workshop, and we'll actually start in full force with Writers Matter every day there. And if I'm allowed to travel there in August, then we'll actually do some pretext exercises. So currently the answer is no, they're still very separate. And yeah, it's ongoing.
And all we have in the question box is really more praise for your project than questions.
But if anybody would like to ask a question, and this is the moment, you know, I mean, this is a moment of having these wonderful practitioners and also, I mean, here to absolve any question.
And we have another question now coming from Rachel Cohen. She says that she missed a little bit in the middle of the session, so she's not sure if you've covered this already, but how well do you feel that pretext translates online? Some of my most vivid memories of the pretext training in FTR were the moments of feeling the room, waiting for others to share, and almost feeling everyone thinking and engaging with each other. Maybe that's just me, but I wonder if losing that in virtual setting would change the effect of pretext.
What do you guys think, Harvey or Victoria? Have you tried it already on online?
We haven't tried it. Like the exercise we did it in this session was the first time to try pretext online. I just remember how it was and how it was in Uganda. It's really a difference when you are together in the same room, and you sit together, you share your ideas, you discuss. It's another atmosphere than online, but I think it's also possible to do it online if all the cameras of all participants are on.
Yeah.
Yes. Because I think we just made a brief introduction of how pretext is working.
And also, yeah.
Go ahead, Carrie.
And also just the applause feedback is kind of critical, I found. I guess if everyone is online and there's still latency problems, you know, with interaction. So
mm-hmm. There are certain limitations without a doubt, and perhaps some of the activities in the toolbox that are suggested at the start of a pretext capacitation may not work as well online. But if we follow some of the simple tenets that build this protocol, everyone being able to see each other, a platform that allows that, having a moment of reflection after an activity, I think today's activity actually worked quite similarly to what it would have worked in a live classroom, right? Mm-hmm. If we were able to see each other and had the time to build different soundtracks and listen to the how it influences the text.
Exactly. I think it's a matter of getting used to the new tool, to the new environment. I think it's capable to translate. Obviously, not all the exercises, but most of them can be I think easily translatable. And yes, I mean there is no doubt about the importance of the face to face. That's why we are in a circle. if we show everybody in the screen, you know, the 25 of us, you know, that usually that's the number, the magical number that we like to have at a maximum number of participants in order to be able for everybody to talk and everybody to see each other. You know, this is it might be feasible to do it, to replicate it in a way. We are learning this way. I mean, we're learning just the same way that I think we are all learning. I mean, I was shift as any other professor in this country, you know, in the United States, you know, to online very fast, you know, within a week. And I thought it was not going to be possible for me to teach, you know, in the same way. And I did it, you know, we did it, you know, it came out okay. As more time passes, we're pretty sure that probably we'll be able to produce, you know, exercises which are, you know, ones that, you know, that come out of this electronic environment that we can do electronically, that we can work electronically. So I think it does translate in most of the cases. Obviously not in all of them, but no, I think it's important.
And Jose, well, we prep alumnus of the program who just mentioned in the chat box that she has been leading pretext sessions online. So Natalia, if you could turn Joan into a panelist and ask her to turn on her webcam. I would like Wonderful. To bring a question for Victoria, actually.
Yeah.
How did you go about choosing the text? Do you find that it's important to choose a challenging text, as Dr. Somers explains, or did you look for a text that had more relevance to your program? How did you go about choosing the text?
I think both is possible, because I'm now thinking about what kind of pretext activities we are going to resume when we are allowed to again, to do it on ground, because internet connection sometimes is a bit challenging over there. but for instance, for our case, we chose the magic flute, which is relevant to our project because we wanted to work on a musical piece, but which also has kind of a a challenging text. We designed we didn't copy paste the whole libretto of the opera. We simplified a little bit to shorten the plot. So I think both is possible. It's possible to, when you want to engage more in literacy, to engage the people to be able to work with difficult texts, then you go for it. But when you, now you need it more relevance to your project, then it's also fine to not pay attention if it's a very difficult text or a more simple text, but you will still find your activities going along with the pretext.
One element that we underscore in the program, even though I love your answer, is that difficulty is or can be an aesthetic value, right? No. That going at a text once and time again, it really, the sense of pride that happens in the group is kind of elevated as achieving breaking into a difficult text, but it doesn't always have to be that way. Mm-hmm. Joan, welcome. Hi. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. So I run a program, it's a string orchestra. We also sit in a circle. We've been going for 7 years, and we mix both privileged and underserved populations to work together. And we were doing orchestra online. We went to Zoom like other people were, and it wasn't doing what we normally do with rehearsals, wasn't working so well. And so we decided to run our first summer program, and we meet just for an hour a day, and we're studying Don Quixote. So the ages are 7 to 11, and actually we've one 13-year-old, but it's mostly 7 to 11. And what we've been doing is we've been reading parts of it, and then I've been asking them to go and bring something the next day that something that they have in their house from their culture or something that they create that struck them after what we read. Mm-hmm. And the conversations that have come up are extraordinary. And mm-hmm. the things, and I've said, you know, and we use Flipgrid, so people can post on Flipgrid. That's like our clothesline. People can go on whenever they want, look on Flipgrid to see what people are doing. But it's so interesting how the conversations that someone will come and say, well, I was thinking about it, and I think that Don Quixote has entitlement issues because he didn't think that he should pay when he stayed at the inn. And a seven-year-old said, so Don Quixote loves this woman, but he's never met her and he's never seen her. And he said, that kind of reminds me of religion. A seven-year-old. You know, I was like, it was incredible. It's like they can be elephants in the room online in a way that I even wonder if we were in person and because their parents are there when we're in person, but the parents aren't there when we're online. And so this has been a revelation to me. Mm-hmm. And of course, I have to be really careful to just have no opinion and just, that's so interesting. Thank you for sharing, you know, and then we do discuss what did we do. And some, it's been interesting. You know, some of the kids are shy to have, they don't want their picture there. Our goal, though, is actually to do a video of this piece, Don Quixote, that was written for us. But I went with the pretext to try to help make the piece come alive and get them to practice. But actually, the pretext part has been the most exciting part.
That's wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful to know and wonderful to hear and wonderful to, I mean, I just wanted to go back to one of our own personal memory, you know, together with the text of, with the difficulty of the text. This text that by Borges is one of the most, Borges is probably the most difficult writer that we have in Spanish language in the last, you know, the last part of the 20th century. And we, the very first workshop that we ever did on pretext was with this text, Los Dos Reyes y Los Dos Laberintos, the two kings. And we did it in Chalco, in a very, very, very poor neighborhood of outside Mexico City, when they were all of us telling, when everybody was telling us that that is not a good text because it had nothing to do with them and it was too difficult. And these are, again, once more, when Pedro mentioned the importance of the difficulty in order to be able to grab from something. That there is somewhere to grab in order to be able to open up things, and that's something that is clear, you know. And the idea, I mean, we had a wonderful success with it, and just in the same way that Don Quixote, which is also a challenging text, showing that there is, I mean, these are challenging texts that people don't want to read, and all of a sudden they are mastering precisely because of you are linking it to the text. I mean, they bring an object, but the object has to be linked. That means interpreted through the text. You know, you are making that movement outside a movement inwards, you know, I mean, for the text, which is, I think, is a way of owning it. All of a sudden, you are immersed in the text. And that way, you're reading better. And again, you have these aha moments as she's having this. What you see in pretext a lot is this incredible sense of admiration about your peer. You know, this is just, you know, the admiration is what you have when you treat everybody as artists, is the final result.
We're seeing a few questions in the question box about how to access pretexts. And Jose, I think you'd be best equipped to answer this question. Could they go to the pretext.org website to find facilitators in their area? How would you go about this?
Very good. The best thing to do is to send us an email to us, and see where we can, how we can connect and get together. My email is falcone@culturalagents.org, but you can have it in our webpage, you know, the info@culturalagents.org. And from there we can see what we can, what kind of program can we have, and work with you guys. It is, we, as Pedro knows and our friends here know, it is a training that takes a few days, you know, it takes usually a week, it's 25 hours. We want to, and it's in small groups, 25 people, 15 hours, 25 people. So it is a training because, again, what's more, the idea is to create a habit. It's to create a habit. The habit is what is important. Here we are trying to reset habits. So we will be very happy to get in touch with anyone. I can put my email there. We are based, as we said, at Harvard University and in Boston. So we are in the United States. But once they reopen again, you know, we travel constantly, continuously. I mean, Doris and I, and everyone else from the team. We have a good team in Colombia. We have a wonderful team in Mexico. We have been working, obviously, across the Americas. That's our work. Me as Doris as one of the leading experts of Latin American literature, you know, in the world. You know, she has been traveling around the continent. In my case, as a contemporary art curator for the last, 20 years. So we have been able to do a lot of projects from Argentina, Brazil, Chile, as you know, not only the one in Frutillar, but also some other parts of Santiago. Colombia is a big hub for us. Mexico is a big hub for us, but we have done it in Puerto Rico, Bahamas, and of course in Europe too. In Dublin, we have a good number of people that work there. There are facilitators there, and many other parts of the world. So be very happy to talk to all of you and to any of you. I mean, in order to be able to continue this mission.
Jose, thank you. I think it's wonderful words to wrap this session up. I would like to invite Gosha again to invite us to next week's events. And before Gosha takes it away, Victoria, Harvey, and Jose, thank you so much for joining us today to introduce the publication in Musical Spaces.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you, Pedro. You have been a magician. Thank you. Thank you for everything.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you, Jose. Thank you, Harvey, Victoria, Pedro, and everyone who has joined the session today from around the world. Using this occasion, I would like to encourage you to visit our website to learn about our resources and events, as well as follow us on social media. Speaking about next week, Grounded in Rhythm, Explore Emotional Intelligence Through Music with Caleb Spaulding. This will happen on Wednesday, July 8th at 3 p.m. Eastern Time. Using the drum as an anchor, Caleb will lead participants through a rhythmically breathing exercise, calming the nervous system and creating a relaxing rhythmic soundscape. Participants will then be led through a guided meditation that focuses on the rhythm of the heart and activating the body through tapping and some movement. Also, next week we have another episode of Resetting the Stage, a series which is dedicated to exploring deeply important and rapidly evolving themes in the industry. Who you are before what you do, culture first organizations. Thursday, July 9th at 1 p.m. Eastern Time, we will have illustrious industry experts, including Jenny Billfield from Washington Performing Arts, Scott Harrison from Blume Haiti, Jamie Martin from National Symphony Orchestra, RTE, Elena Musler from Loyola Marymount University, and Julie Off from Miami City Ballet. We really do hope to see you there during our webinars. Thank you again. Have a good afternoon, have a good evening, or good rest of the day. Stay safe and healthy. See you soon.